At the beginning of this course, when I said that I was interested in the question of whether the naturalistic version of Buddhism might qualify as a spiritual or even a religious worldview, I brought out this William James quote, where James said that the animating essence of religion is the belief that there is an unseen order and that our supreme good lies in harmoniously adjusting ourselves to that order. And I said kind of tentatively that it would seem that Buddhism offers such a thing. You know, it says that the truth about the world is generally unseen, and that if we discover it and harmoniously align ourselves with the truth, then we will, in some sense, realize our supreme good. Well, since I said that, you know, I think we've learned a lot more about what the truth is that Buddhism asserts. So maybe we're in a better position now to ask ourselves whether it really is an unseen order in the sense that James meant the term, okay, whether it really might qualify even a naturalistic Buddhism to be a kind of spiritual or religious worldview. Well, certainly it's unseen, right? I mean, if you take this truth about reality to be the thing that becomes clear when you've attained enlightenment, well, most people are nowhere near enlightenment, and so are nowhere near seeing this truth. But is it an order? Okay, is this truth, does this really qualify as an unseen order? Now, that's an important question, because many religions, they assert the existence of an order in the sense of a kind of divinely imparted plan. They say the universe embodies this divinely imparted purpose, this plan. And then, you know, the people who are adherents of that religion, that's where they get the meaning in their lives. Their place in the plan is what gives their lives meaning. It's what gives them moral orientation. And it's what inspires a very powerful commitment to this religious worldview. Well, Buddhism, even religious Buddhism, doesn't say that there's an all-powerful creator God who imparted purpose and a plan to the universe. And certainly this naturalistic Buddhism doesn't say anything about some kind of divinely imparted plan. So the question arises, you know, can this naturalistic Buddhism assert the existence of an unseen order in somewhat the sense that other religions may mean the term, and in a sense that does have power, that does inspire commitment? Well, I think you know, you can argue that that is the case, that when you look at the order that is asserted, it does have some of that kind of inspiration and that kind of potency. Now, first of all, this unseen order is literally orderly, right? I mean, we've just seen that that enlightenment, as we imagine it, would give you a view of the world with tremendous kind of continuity. There would be more continuity among the different things in the world, and there would be more continuity between you and the world. So where there previously had been fragmentation, you would now apprehend this tremendous unity. So this is literally an unseen order. There's a second and maybe deeper sense in which this qualifies as an unseen order. When we looked at that checklist in the previous segment of this lecture, you know, it had two columns, the truth about the world and moral truth. And the idea was the path to enlightenment is the path to both. Right, there's an alignment between these two truths. And that brings us to something that we talked about early in this course, right? Which is that is the Buddhist assertion, that if you see the world clearly, respond appropriately to it, you do align yourself with moral truth. As we saw, this is embodied in the word dharma. Dharma refers to both kind of the natural order and the moral order. And it refers to the teachings about how you should respond to the natural order, to the way things are. And responding in that manner, in the prescribed manner, does align you with the moral truth. So I would say this alignment between the truth about the world and moral truth is itself a kind of unseen order at a very deep level. And, you know, the universe didn't have to be built this way, right? You can imagine a universe where learning the truth about the world brings you no closer to the moral truth. Or if you respond to the truth about the world in ways that bring you happiness, that doesn't bring you any closer to the moral truth or to moral behavior. The universe didn't have to be built this way. But according to Buddhism, it is. There is this alignment between kind of the truth about the world, moral truth, and you know, your fulfillment, the end of your suffering. So it's really kind of the trifecta, right? Is built into this universe, and that's kind of an amazing thing, if true, right? Something worth marveling at. So I guess I would say that even though Buddhism doesn't talk about an order in the sense of a divinely imparted plan that inspires awe and commitment by virtue of it being God's will, nonetheless, there is a kind of order asserted in Buddhism that is in its own way awe-inspiring, and in its own way does really bring commitment and does provide, you know, an incentive to be devoted to the prescribed path. Now, there's one other thing that William James said about religions. James said that religions in general tend to involve, first of all, a sense that there is something wrong about us as we naturally stand, an uneasiness, and a sense that we are saved from the wrongness by making proper connection with the higher powers. Well, Buddhism obviously features the first of those, right? The sense that there's something wrong, right? Dukkha, you know, suffering, unsatisfactoriness. But what about the second thing, the sense that you can be saved by contact with a higher power? Well, certainly, especially with the naturalistic form of Buddhism, this wouldn't be contact with any kind of deity. But I think there is the sense among very serious meditators that sometimes they are making contact with a higher form of awareness in a certain sense, a much purer awareness than was previously available. And that's certainly an interesting scenario, an interesting thing to contemplate. And it suggests a view of our evolutionary history that has almost a mythic quality, okay? Because as far as we can tell, consciousness, subjective experience, can only be created on this planet at least through natural selection, right? But we've also seen that natural selection in creating consciousness tends to warp it. It tends to create these various distortions that we've talked about in perception, in cognition, and certainly in moral judgment. And it's interesting to think that maybe natural selection, having created consciousness and warped it in the first place, nonetheless, eventually gives rise to these kind of self-reflective beings, that would be us, human beings, who figure things out and manage to kind of rid themselves of these distortions, many or even all of these distortions. You know, they kind of manage to liberate consciousness in a certain sense from the distortions that its creator initially imposed on it. Now, of course, you know, again, most of us are not going to attain a pure form of awareness. Presumably that's the kind of thing that would be associated with enlightenment if you ever got there. But I do think there are very serious meditators who wouldn't make any claim to having been enlightened, who nonetheless have had a sense of contact with that kind of purity of awareness. You know, moments in meditation where you feel you're really in touch with the real truth about things, and that your perception is just no longer kind of distorted by the normal distortions. And I think those experiences, those moments of seeming contact with the real truth about things, do inspire commitment to the practice that is in some ways comparable in its power to the commitment that is inspired in other religions by kind of their version of a connection with higher powers. So is this naturalistic version of Buddhism a religious worldview? Is it a spiritual worldview? I'll let you make the call. I would say that if you look at the way William James framed the thing, it does arguably qualify. You know, there is the belief that there's an unseen order in a fairly profound sense, and that yes, our supreme good lies in adjusting ourselves to the order. Also that yes, there is a sense that there's something fundamentally wrong in the human condition, something fundamentally awry, and that the remedy lies in a connection with, in some sense, a higher power, not a higher power in the sense of a deity, but a higher form of awareness that is itself very powerful. So I would say, you know, as naturalistic kind of substitutes for religion go, this one is, you know, not bad. I'd also say that even if you're not looking for a substitute, you know, even if you've already got your own religion in a traditional sense, this kind of naturalistic Buddhism probably also works as a kind of a supplement, right? I mean, the practice of meditation and the basic philosophy that we've seen accompanying it, I think, is compatible with various religious traditions. And I would even say that there's a kind of a synergy between it and the major religious traditions. I think all of these traditions have kind of themes and precepts that really resonate with the worldview we've been describing. I mean, my own upbringing was in the Christian tradition, and so, you know, I think of, for example, Jesus saying, basically, you know, why are you so focused on this speck in the eye of this other guy when you've got, you know, a log lodged in your own eye? In other words, the idea is that, you know, here you are obsessing over this minor perceptual distortion that other people may have when you've got a pretty major one yourself. That's obviously very consistent with kind of this worldview we've been describing. And I know that all the major religions, you know, have these kind of thematic synergies with this worldview. Anyway, whatever you want to call this worldview we've been talking about over these last 6 weeks, you know, this meditative path informed by Buddhist philosophy, whether you want to say, yes, it's a religion, or no, I don't think it qualifies as a religion, but it's a spiritual worldview, or you just want to say it's a therapeutic perspective, or whatever, I would say the following. If you look at the human condition from the standpoint of modern psychology, and in particular evolutionary psychology, and you look at the way our evolutionary history has afflicted us with perceptual distortions and moral biases and dissatisfaction and out-and-out suffering, and you ask, well, is there a worldview that addresses this problem? Well, there are a lot of worldviews, and many of them do it effectively. There are religions, there are therapeutic traditions, but I am not personally aware of a naturalistic worldview that addresses the problem as straightforwardly and as honestly and as unflinchingly as the one we've been talking about. Now, I personally am going to keep exploring this worldview for some time to come in one sense or another. Maybe some of you will too, but whether or not you do that, I want to thank you for sharing in my exploration of it. I've gotten a tremendous amount out of teaching this course, out of preparing the material for presentation, but also, more importantly, out of the online interaction with students and you know, getting the feedback about the ideas and the way I presented them. And I can honestly say that as a result of all that, I am now seeing things more clearly than I was before, so thank you for that.